there's really an effort. There's an effort to effectively abolish the family.
Yeah.
Some people may remain happily married, but the damage it does to society, because the legalization of divorce doesn't just affect the families that get divorced. It affects every family in the country. Of all people, Vladimir Putin gave a speech in the last few days, and he said, you know, these things are not new. We did them all starting in 1917, and they were disasters. There are active feminists who are strongly in favor of it because they see it as a liberation for women. Mm-hmm. It's produced in a catastrophic level of poverty among women in the United States.
And not harmful to children.
Right. Well, yeah, I don't know that they think about that because it's
exactly.
Not...
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's episode of the Dr. J Show. Today, I have a very special guest from the Philippines. Mr. Timothy Laws is associated with an organization in the Philippines, a pro-family organization over there called the Alliance for the Family Foundation Philippines. They've been involved in some important activism over there, which we would very much like to share with you. So those of you who are here in the United States, particularly if you are on the West Coast of the United States and you're Catholic, you may have Philippine friends, because I know for a fact that the only thing holding the church together in California is the Mexicans and the Filipinos. Oh, wait, did she really say that? Sorry, but look, if you have Philippine friends, please forward this podcast to them, because they're going to be very interested in what our guest has to say. Mr. Timothy Laws, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you, Doctor.
So Tim, tell us a little bit about how you came to be involved in pro-family activity in the Philippines. You're not originally from the Philippines, but you live there. Tell people just briefly about how you got involved.
Well, I was involved in pro-family activity in the States, actually more pro-life at that time. Originally, I started to look for something to, after I got out of college, I wanted to look for something, some way to help make the world a better place. So I looked around and I saw that hunger was the, hunger and starvation were the biggest injustice in the world at that time, arguably at least. And so I was involved in that for a number of years, but then we had the growth of abortion in the United States, and it came to me, my understanding was that that was really a bigger injustice. Uh-huh. Because it was involved a direct killing of people for whatever reason.
Right.
So I became active in that. So I was, these are related issues, all of them are actually. So when I came to the Philippines, well, actually part of the motivation for moving to the Philippines is abortion is illegal here, totally, yes. Totally illegal. It's one of, perhaps no other country has the same protection. Although that isn't to say it doesn't happen. Unfortunately.
Right, of course.
You know, it does
right.
happen, but it is illegal. So that was another big motivation for moving here was there's no divorce. There hasn't been earlier in the American occupation period, I believe it was, there was a divorce law, which makes sense. It was part of the United States. So divorce was permitted. But after the independence, and particularly with the recent constitution, well, recent 1987, divorce was completely forbidden. Although there are some exceptions, if you were married in another country and obtain a divorce there, it's recognized here.
I see.
Actually, I think... Yeah, maybe one of the spouses has to be not Filipino, though. I'm not sure. It's a detail. So there are some rare exceptions that exist. But so when I got here and learned that there were several issues going on. A particular divorce was already. We moved here in 1996. By 1999, that's when ALFI. Properly known as ALFI, the Alliance for the Family Foundation, came into existence because there was a bill in the Congress to legalize divorce. And the people realized this was something very serious and organized this NGO, a foundation,
yes.
to work to combat it. There was also talk of legalizing abortion in the country.
So now, the way I found out about your organization was through a podcaster who invited me to be on his show. And I found out from him that there is a push right now, a very active push to make divorce legal, to change the divorce laws. And the Ruth Institute, as you know, is completely opposed to U.S. divorce law. The last thing I want to see is our terrible divorce system imported into one of the last Catholic countries in the world. You know, it's been a disaster for us. It would be a disaster for you. But one of the other things I'm aware of about the Philippines is that is your reproductive health law. And I wonder if, Tim, if you want to say something, a little bit of something about the reproductive health law, because this was another instance where there was a very solid pro-life, pro-family kind of law in the Philippines that was undermined in a systematic manner. So are do you feel good? Do you feel prepared to talk about the reproductive health law, Tim?
Yes. So we were involved, very heavily involved in that battle. Lasted 14 years before they managed to get that passed. But it was successfully opposed for 13 years.
That's right. That's
finally,
right.
Finally, that it couldn't be done anymore, any further, for various reasons, unfortunately. So we wound up with the reproductive health law, which, yeah, again, is, well, both divorce and the reproductive health law as it exists are going to be catastrophic for the country over the long term.
Right. So tell people, so Tim, tell people what the reproductive health law did.
Yeah, what it did was put the government in a position of promoting contraceptives and making them available at no charge to every woman in the country, basically. Although there are restrictions on minors at this point, but they keep trying. When they passed the law, they even wrote that there would be no restriction on minors. But my organization, well, there are a few organizations that filed a lawsuit against the law because it was incompatible with the Philippine Constitution, which is laudably, you know, probably the strongest, or maybe certainly in the top few strongest pro-life constitutions in the world, and defense of family as well. One thing I mentioned is the Philippine Constitution actually mentions the sanctity of human life, and that's not a word that occurs in law or in medicine, you know, right. but it's there. That's a great thing. As I was saying, my organization and a few others and some individuals filed a lawsuit against the reproductive health bill after it passed. And it took a few years for it to be adjudicated because we went directly to the Supreme Court, which was, in fact, unheard of, although it was permitted under the law, but nothing had ever done that before, as I understand it. And it was actually the president of our organization who was the one who argued the case. She's an attorney.
I see.
She argued the case before the Supreme Court. And unfortunately, they held it to be constitutional that the government would promote contraception. Although, if you look at it objectively, there's certainly grounds, especially with the Philippine Constitution, they could have declared it unconstitutional,
right?
Because it's very, very deleterious effects on the state, the families, everyone. But I think, you know, it's understandable that they knew the whole world would come knocking at their door if they did something like that.
So let me just clarify for our American listeners. Okay, prior to this reproductive health law, was contraception illegal in the Philippines?
No, it was not. No, it was legal, but you understand that the Philippines is a developing country, and many of the people, although that's a myth too, many of the people do not have, you know, have very limited incomes. And the idea was, well, they don't use contraception because they can't afford it.
Right.
But in actuality, there have been a number of studies showing that's not how it works.
Right.
A professor of the practice of economic development at the Kennedy School of Business at Harvard, who showed clearly that of the vast decrease in fertility that occurred during the 20th century, 95% of it was not due to contraception.
Now, do you know who that was?
His name, Lant Pritchett.
Okay.
Lant Pritchett. And Yeah, and he's, you know, he's written some other significant papers. If I recall, that paper was even attacked by the Guttmacher Institute.
Sure.
And he wrote a response showing that they were wrong. You know,
okay. So let's pause. Let's pause right here, because you've said already a number of things that are going to be surprising to some of our listeners. Okay. So first of all, the fact that contraception was legal in the Philippines was not enough to satisfy the international community. That's the first point, right? Yes. And the second point is that what they wanted to do was to actively promote it, the government to actively promote it, right? Mm-hmm. And then thirdly, that their motivation for this supposedly was economic development. And there's questionable whether that's a real thing, right? Right, whether that's factually correct.
That was really the primary driver. There was a lot of efforts from outside the country to move that along, including funding. And, you know, there's different agendas there. But I think sincerely that the people who voted for it thought it would be a good thing. So
yes, the people inside your country who voted for it, but undoubtedly by that time thought it was a good thing. I remember when this was coming down, I want to say it was 2012 that it finally went through.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Late in 2012.
Yes. Because I was writing about it when it was going on, because I could see, you know, that this was not going to be a good thing. And one of the things that I noticed in collecting my, you know, a little bit of information about it is that yes, Philippine population is growing, but in part that's because child mortality and adult mortality has dropped. It's not that the birth rate has already been falling quite a lot.
In 1950, the average Filipina had, I think, 8 children.
Yes.
And by that time it was down to 3.
That's right.
That's
right. And so, you know, so to my mind, you know, Three children per woman is not an outrageously high fertility rate, you know. But tell people a little bit, because we've kind of hinted around a bit about this. Tell people a little bit about the international community, so-called the international agencies that were involved in this campaign within the Philippines.
Well, as I understand it, there wasn't a lot of information about that available. We wondered about it because we would have liked to know if we could show this. But of course, blow a trumpet and announce that they're funding movements in other countries. They do it quietly. But I understand there are records, documentary records that the UNFPA was funding the efforts, and in IPPF, International Planned Parenthood Federation. They both definitely, you know, I'm not 100% certain, but that's credibly, yes, they were there. Now, and there may have been others. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me at all. There was talk, and it makes sense. In fact, it would be hard to believe it were otherwise, that the pharmaceutical companies also were willing to contribute to the cause, because it opened a big new market, 100 million people.
That's right. So with that past in our minds, you know, that's this multiple year effort to change the law around contraceptive use, to make the government an active promoter of contraception. With that in mind, let's talk now a little bit about the effort to redefine the divorce law, to change the divorce law. Tell people, again, review for us, what is the current law of divorce, and what are they trying to change it to?
Yeah, the current law is something I'm personally proud of, and I'm not Filipino, but they tell me I'm half Filipino many times. But we're the only country in the world where divorce is forbidden. It's just very simple. You know, there's one other country, although that's a quasi-country. The Vatican City State has no divorce either. But other than that, it's the two of us.
Right.
But that's a good thing. And actually, you know, people think, wow, that they might, you know, a modern person who grew up now thinks that's really strange. And yet, you know, previously it was often like that.
Right. And so what do they want to change it to?
Well, to divorce. The law is written as not no fault divorce. It requires grounds. They included, there is an annulment law in the Philippines. if a marriage was invalid from the beginning,
right,
then it can be nullified. That's why it's an annulment. And that has certain grounds. For instance, I think alcoholism is one of them. So those grounds have been adopted into the new bill as well. And I think it's been broadened, though. There are additional grounds.
So one very specific question, is one of the grounds something along the lines of irreconcilable differences or irretrievable breakdown? Is there a ground something like that?
I'm not certain.
Okay.
I have to say, I'm not certain about that. With the annulment law, I believe they've shied away from that. It's more like the traditional law in the states earlier, before the no-fault came along. There had to be adultery or abandonment or separation for a number of years, that you haven't lived together for a number of years. I don't believe that simple or reconcilable differences. The other thing is, in the law, to their credit, holding on to the past a little bit, you can't have a stipulated divorce. That would be equivalent to a no-fault divorce. We agree, he's cheating on me, and that's it. So we'd sign the paper here and now it's done. But you have to prove it.
I see. So, okay. So that's what a stipulated divorce is, meaning that both parties agree that these are the facts. So you're going to have some evidence.
Yeah. Yes.
The problem with changing the law in this direction is that the gates are open to additional grounds and to interpretive license, shall we say, on the part of the courts and so on, the wink and the nod at the evidence and, that sort of a thing. So tell me, Tim, what are some of the arguments in favor of relaxing the divorce laws, making it more readily available? What are the arguments?
The great argument, it was always going to be, as is with all these social issues, it's always the hard case, the worst case.
Right.
There is. What about the wife who's being beaten up by her husband every day? You say that they should stay together, and that's a reason. That is true. Those people should not be together, and they should be able to get legally separated so that they don't interfere with each other. And I don't think there's a jurisdiction in the world that doesn't recognize that. But there is a way to do that here. There is a legal separation law. So you can get a court order, order of protection, your financial arrangements are divided and settled juridically, and so on. The only thing that is different is you can't remarry.
Right.
And some people say that's an imposition. Why? What gives you the right to say to these people that they can't remarry? And then we point out that that's an illusory remedy, because the chances are much greater that you'll be divorced in that second marriage than you were in the first marriage. That's reality. It's more likely to fail. So it's conceivable. Some people may remain happily married. But the damage it does to society, because the legalization of divorce doesn't just affect I'm sure you're aware of this, doesn't just affect the families that get divorced. It affects every family in the country, because this has been documented within social science, that you have to behave differently with your spouse and your children, because this is lurking in the gorillas, lurking in the background, divorce is there. It affects every family.
Yes.
And it cheapens marriage. It lessens the appeal of marriage. And that's one of the things, a big point that I wanted to make is, you say, you're totally opposed to the divorce in the United States. Okay, there's divorce, but let's not forget marriage. There's an article written by a sociologist from the University of Maryland named Philip Cohen that was published in The Atlantic, which major intellectual magazine, I guess you say, in the States. And he said, marriage is dying out in the United States. And you say, really? This was a graph since 1950 for 60 years. This was written in 2013. So he had data up to 2011. So for 60 straight years, the number of marriages per person, per 1,000 people in the United States has been dropping in a straight line. It's headed towards zero. And he gave three alternative scenarios maybe there'll be a rebound, or maybe it'll flatten out and, a status quo, or maybe it goes down to none in the year 2040. Well, I went and checked that since this is now 2021, about a year ago, I got data up to 2019, and we're in the lower line.
Yeah,
it's hold true. It's now it's not 60 years; it's 70 years that the number of marriages are going to zero in the country.
Right.
So that's what you get with no fault divorce. You know, there is the example of.
And I think it's wise to point out the ramifications, some of these ramifications that you've been hinting at. But before we do that, I want to just say something about the hard case. Okay, the hard case. I have a very dear friend who is in one of those hard cases. You know, a husband who's mentally ill, husband who's violent. She did everything she could to try to preserve the marriage, including go to her church authority. She's not Catholic, but she did what she could do within her religion. And she said to me at some point, she said, if I divorce him, if we get divorced, it doesn't really solve the problem because he's still crazy. He's still the father of our children. They still have a crazy father, right? But now he can go marry someone else. How does that help? He can go inflict all that on another family. You know, legally, he can do that. So the problem of his spousal misconduct, you know, if you want to call it that, because that's, you know, in a way what we're talking about, the problem of spousal misconduct has not been solved. Mm-hmm. It's just been transferred. And in a way, it's been unbounded. You know, it's taken on a whole new dimension, you know, yes. Because the new family may have no clue. You know, he doesn't have to reveal. You know, it's not like he has a damaged good label on his head or something, you know, so that people would be warned off of him, you know. Mm-hmm. But the arrangement that you guys have in the Philippines now is an arrangement that provides protection for the innocent parties. It provides protection without turning that guy loose on the whole rest of society. So I just wanted to point that out. That.
Yeah, that's an interesting example. Yes.
And when you think about it, when you look at the Gospels, where and we can talk about God at the Ruth Institute. It's okay. When you look at the Gospel, Jesus's prohibition on divorce is really what we would say a prohibition on remarriage. It's the second marriage that becomes adulterous. Yes. And that he's saying, no, you can't do that. And that was such an innovation. That was so radical. The apostles were freaked out when he said it. You know, like, we can't do that. That's too hard. And yet what we do know, one of the things we know from the children of divorce is that second marriage, that attempt to start new unions, that is one of the things that is so disruptive in the lives of children, mm-hmm. to see their parents take on new spouses, new lovers, new boyfriends, that they are now, as children, expected to treat like a parent. You know, it's extremely difficult for the children.
Yeah, well, and the social science literature points out that it doesn't work. That
right.
The negative consequences of divorce are not alleviated, and for some markers they are worsened in the case of remarriage.
That's right.
So
that's right.
It's the children who are the principal victims.
And the adult children, you know, we've interviewed a number of people, you know, who are knowledgeable about this or who have experienced it. The adult children will tell you that it's the attempted new marriages that just wreaked so much havoc in their lives, you know, watching their parent negotiate new love relationships. Mm-hmm. And that becomes the focus of the parents' life. They're not concerned about the children as much. They're trying to build up that new relationship. And if the new guy doesn't like the kids and, you know, it just, and even when they like their stepdad or they like their stepmom, you know, there are still complications introduced into their lives that are, people don't appreciate. Sorry.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you can see that way that would be the case because you're shoveling, you know, in many cases you either do not see one of the parents any further, usually the father, or you shuttle back and forth between them. So your life's in a constant flux. So it's not hard to understand how that would be very debilitating.
Do you think people in the Philippines who are considering this legislation, do you think they're aware of what that's like for kids to go back and forth every week or every 2 weeks or something?
Probably not, because that's one thing is there's no experience of it here.
Right.
We pointed out in a congressional hearing that, you know, people think there's divorce. Okay, it's going to help a few people. There's probably going to be a minimum of 100,000 divorces a year here. maybe 200,000. And so the average family has three children. That's 300 to 600,000 children who are going to be affected by divorce every year. And,
right.
You know, people, you know, they don't think about that. But
right.
It's no, this is a matter between two people and their kids. That, but it's you're going to multiply it by large numbers.
That's right. And then you were talking about the ways that it has ripple effects through society. One of the ripple effects is that the children of divorce have more difficulty forming their own lifetime relationships.
Yeah.
Right. They have trouble forming unions. They have trouble keeping them stable and so on, which is part of that trend line that you're seeing.
Yeah. Well, this is not divorces. This is marriages.
Correct.
So it's the trend line. Yeah. I see. Yeah. You're right. The right. That's true. But even the ones who do marry, I came across a figure recently in a paper. I mean, it's the only, yeah, we're out, Alliance for the Family is a secular organization. We do not, base anything on religious principles. It's a science, social science.
Right.
And if you have a marriage where there's both children come from divorced families, their chances of divorcing approach certainty.
Right.
They're really much more likely to get divorced than they are to stay married for a lifetime.
Yeah. Exactly.
So
if you let that system go for a generation or two, which we have now done it here in the US, what you see is young adults afraid of getting married in the first place.
Yes.
Because they've already been through a couple divorces with their parents' divorces.
Yes. Yes.
They don't want that, you know.
Yeah.
So talk to us about what is actually happening. Is this bill being considered right now? Is it going to get voted on soon? What's the facts on the ground about how this thing is going?
Well, the bill was introduced. Congress runs for a 3-year term here, unlike the states where it's 2 years. And I think it was introduced fairly early in the current term, which expires next year, 2022. But just recently, it was passed by one of the committees. There's many different committees. So it's a little hard to remember which, but I mean, it's something to do with children, but maybe not. Passed by one of the committees in the lower house, the House of Representatives, same as in the states. Unfortunately, it shows how, you know, the whole idea spread. It was passed unanimously.
Wow.
It's such a shame that, it's people start to think alike, when confronted with this information. So, but there's still, the future is uncertain, for a number of reasons. First of all, it now goes to go to both like the finance committee and the rules committee.
I see.
And who knows, you know, how long it will take there because they have other urgent business. It's not the only issue being debated in Congress. And then, of course, it has to pass the Senate as well. And that's, I think its chances are considered to be less certain there. But in addition to all that, there is a nationwide election coming next year. And as in the States, all the attention is focused on that now. So
yes.
There's not a lot of attention focused on other things. So it's difficult to say whether there'll be action on the bill, but we're hopeful. You know, we're hopeful. Those of us who are opposed to it, we're hopeful that it may. That doesn't solve the problem because you can be certain it'll be introduced. In fact, maybe this is the one. Some of these, social issue things get HB 001. You know that because it's the first bill refiled when the new Congress starts, which shows they keep presenting. We saw that with the reproductive health bill. Every Congress would come back. You know, then sometimes a few changes, other times no changes at all, basically. So.
So and they wear you down. It's a strategy of attrition. They just chip, wear you down continue.
Well, they don't give up. You know, that's a reality. And it's part of, you know, that was one thing, one point that should be made it's part of a larger picture of what's happening in the world. There's really an effort to, I think it's even shown in documents, there's an effort to effectively abolish the family.
Yeah.
People think the world will be better off because the family is a place of abuse and patriarchy, of course. And so we'd be better off without her. Of course, interestingly, of all people, Vladimir Putin gave a speech in the last few days, and he said, you know, these things are not new. We did them all starting in 1917, and they were disasters. So we should learn from their experience.
Yes. Yeah, that's actually a very interesting thing, because the communists thought this was such a great idea, and they introduced divorce, and they had to back off from it because it was so chaotic. It was
I think it's ironic, you know, it tells you something about the one who reversed it was Joseph Stalin.
Right.
Yeah, he reinstituted marriage, you know.
So, because it interfered, because the divorce law created so much social chaos that it interfered with their other ideological plans of, yes, you know, whatever else it was at that time. You know, they just couldn't get anything done. And so, that's a very interesting little historical quirk there that happened. Tell me, who is promoting the drive to change the divorce law? Is there anybody, are there established organizations there? Are there outside, you know, other NGOs, perhaps international NGOs? Who's behind this drive? Who wants this so badly?
I know there are active feminists, I guess you would say, third wave feminists, here, who are strongly in favor of it because they see it as a liberation for women, mm-hmm. Which is a misunderstanding, unfortunately,
right.
that they have this view, because it's not liberating. You know, in the end, it's produced in a catastrophic level of poverty among women in the United States, for example. The divorce, 40% of all women who are divorced are in poverty, I believe. So so there's definitely those who are of the feminist persuasion. I'm not sure. Yeah, well, and there's other progressive organizations here, none that you'd recognize the names of, I think, in the West. But there are local organizations that, again, it's universally supported when it is supported by those groups, it's as a liberation for women.
Mm-hmm. And not harmful to children.
Right. Well, I don't know that they think about that, because it doesn't involve children.
Exactly.
It's about a man and a woman who want to get a divorce.
So,
I'd expect that would be perfectly natural. I mean, maybe if I were among them, I'd think the same way.
Right.
But
right.
The reality is that's it. It's devastating for children. Yeah. It's hard to keep every marker of or index of welfare that has ever been studied by social scientists. They fare worse,
yes,
than children.
Yes, there's no doubt about it, really. You know, if you were going to follow the science, you would not end up with liberalized divorce laws. You know, that would not be what you would do. Tell me, is the Catholic Church involved in this conversation or battle at all?
They are, but I have to say it's quite limited. They haven't issued when big issues like the reproductive health law, they would issue a, I can't remember the name for, like an encyclical, but it's a local encyclical, I guess.
Right.
I'd say, but they issued a statement in this case, which is not, it's not theological. I guess that's one of the differences. And it was brief. But that doesn't get much play. Some of the new local news media picked it up. Some very favorite, well, including the government press agency, reprinted almost verbatim to their mm-hmm. credit. Mm-hmm. But the not, it doesn't get much attention, and about at least two of the bishops have made this an issue out of 80 some dioceses here, but there's no campaign against this, unfortunately. My preference would be there would be some sort of campaign, because if people realize what this is going to do, as with the reproductive health law, they would be out in the streets, everybody,
right,
but that's it. Nobody realizes it,
because
they're busy. Everybody's busy. They have problems.
Yep.
They have things to do. Yeah,
right.
That's true. Unfortunately, it's hard to reach them, because all those with access to the people are in favor of this. So they don't allow dissent, as we're seeing with so many other issues.
Right. The official and mainstream mass communication channels are all on one side of this issue, and so you have to have your own paths to the people to get your message out.
in fairness, because someone may see this from here. Actually, one of the major, in fact, they used to be the major video outlet in the country, did give us actually it was supposed to be a debate between the principal sponsor in the Congress of this bill, and it was our senior vice president was asked to represent us. But for whatever reason, the congressman wasn't able to make it to the so we had 1 hour to add to issue our yes, unopposed, she made the good points that minds should have been changed, or at least people should have been
right.
I was thinking maybe we need to think more about this,
So let's do talk about some of those threads that weave through society, where if you redefine the divorce law, some of the different things that are going to happen. Tim, from your perspective, what do you and your alliance see as some of the big consequences that you're emphasizing over there?
Well, it's going to create, undoubtedly, it will create an intractable poverty among some people, a segment of the population that gets divorced, because that has occurred in the United States, where they're now passing budget items in the trillions of dollars, as if they're, without giving it much thought, showing the amount of resources that are available in the United States to combat poverty. And we've spent, I think it's over $20 trillion since Lyndon Johnson declared the war on poverty in late 60s. $20 trillion, yet poverty is just the same as it was before. There's no less poverty than there was $20 trillion earlier. So, the Philippines doesn't have trillions of dollars to deal with it.
Right.
Unfortunately, someday maybe we will, someday, hopefully, but we don't now. But the problem will be there of people who are put into poverty because they're in single families. So that tends to put you in poverty.
And let's explain how that works, just to be real nuts and bolts about it. You've got a household where maybe you have two earners, maybe you don't have two earners, but you've got a household, husband and wife cooperating with each other, and they have their children and they're taken care of. Now you're going to separate that. And now you've got the same amount of resources supporting two different households.
Yes.
Okay. So, you really can't make it so everybody's better off from a financial perspective, right? Because everything that was pooled, everything that was done jointly is now having to be replicated. You have to have two apartments. You have to have two sets of furniture. The children have to have two beds, one bed in each. All of those kinds of things end up being replicated. So that's certainly one important aspect of it. Then one of the issues that we ended up with here, and you will end up with this whether you like it or not, is that the courts are going to get involved in separating the family's assets. Okay. And when the courts get involved in separating the family assets, now you're talking about warfare. Where there was conflict in the family, it can get magnified, and often does get magnified when it gets funneled through the family courts, where whoever wins the battle in the family court gets basically to have the policemen come and back up their decisions, and so the stakes ratchet up, people invest more and more in their strategy. And our friend Stephen Baskerville has written a lot about that. And we've talked about that in previous episodes of the Dr. J Show, that that involvement is itself a huge part of the problem, because all sorts of resources go into the division of the resources, So that's another factor. What other things have you guys thought about or are concerned about?
If we do have a couple hundred thousand divorces a year, and you have all these children grow up, and there is definitely going to be a generation that is not as equipped to take their place in the world when they reach adulthood. They don't have the skills as well as people who don't go through this trauma, because the children divorced don't do as well in school, and it's shown they don't earn as much in their lifetime.
Yeah.
As the parents divorced, you don't earn as much as in your lifetime. You don't live as long.
Yeah.
As people who didn't go through divorce. So all these things are going to come into play. It's not going to be so much something very visible you can put your finger on and see it, because on an individual basis, it's a small effect. But when you have this multiplied by the hundreds of thousands, it's going to be a significant effect.
Yes. Yes. And another aspect of it is strategic, what I would call strategic behavior inside the marriage. So when you know that divorce is a possibility, one of the things that we can kind of, you can track in the United States and see is that it's something that tends to keep women in the workplace longer than they otherwise would be strategically, because they're thinking to themselves, you know, at the beginning of no-fault divorce, people didn't think this way so consciously, but by now people are explicit about it. You know, I need to get my advanced degree. The babies have come. I would like to stay home with them, but I can't quit my job because what if my husband leaves me and I've lost my career path? I need to keep my earning power as high as possible because my husband might leave me, you know? So that kind of strategic behavior, you know, where you're always kind of looking over your shoulder, hedging your bets, you know, that this is not going to be for life. And so therefore you have to plan as if you're going to be a single mom.
You're raising a point that, I'm not familiar with, so there's another consideration.
Well, we've been at this a lot longer than you have, Tim. So it has, and so some of those consequences, some people would say, oh, that's great. That means women will work longer. They'll be more educated. Isn't that great? Well, up to a point, women working more and women having education, up to a point, that's a good thing. But that's not actually what women want. A lot of women would like to be home with their kids more. But they're afraid, you know, and where we see it particularly, my daughter is of that age, you know, where her friends are getting married and, you know, all of that kind of thing. And she has friends who are good practicing Catholics, and she's got friends who are completely unchurched, right? And her unchurched friends explicitly say this: I can't afford to get married and start a family until I'm sure I can raise those kids by myself if my husband chooses to dump me.
Wow. You know? Reality.
That's the reality of the thing. And having the spiritual component to marriage means that you're more committed. Both parties are more committed, so that's less of a factor. But as the society becomes more secularized, fewer people have that. Right. And so so there you go. Yeah. There's a large Philippine diaspora in the world. You know, there are Filipinos, you know, who have immigrated to various places. There are a lot of Filipinos in the United States. There are Filipinos in Japan. There are a lot of Filipinos around the world. Are any Filipino Americans particularly interested or involved in what you guys are trying to do over there?
No, not that we're aware of particularly. There are some, but we don't have any contact with them. You know, I don't know. They may be working in other ways or other groups that fight for the same principles as we do, but we haven't seen that. One problem is that, you know, a lot of the Filipinos tend to get Americanized like all the others, you know, every other group, you know, which in a way is good, you know, that the traditional ideal, and that's not so, it's not looked so favorably upon now, of course,
right.
They might not be so concerned with these issues because they say, no, this is the wave of the future. So,
right. Well, but it's an interesting dynamic that we have in the United States with our immigrant communities, because I would say that the Filipinos in the United States, the Filipino Catholics, they are among the more devout Catholics in the United States. You know, certainly what I was used to in California and so on. And they have some wonderful organizations. I became aware of the Couples for Christ movement, you know, which has Singles for Christ and Kids for Christ and Handmaidens of the Lord, which is the grandmas or, you know, whatever it is. But it's, you know, it's a massive support network that is pro-family in nature, but it's not political at all, as far as I can tell. But that's a lot of people. They get together and they do great stuff. They keep the faith alive, you know, and try to support each other in the faith and so on. You would think there would be some potential for some of them to be concerned about the motherland, you know. Just let me ask you a hypothetical question then. Suppose there were Filipinos, or actually anyone in the United States, who wanted to be of help to you guys and what you're trying to do here on the divorce question. Is there some way that people can help? What could people do that would be helpful to you from afar?
the first thing you'd want to, that I'd say though, is they should become informed about the issues, because then they can talk. When they do talk to people, either their comrades there or here, and the issues come up, or they can bring them up. They can put out the real facts that are not what you're likely to hear from the general media, that it's painted to be opposed to divorce. It's painted as they're antediluvian, that
right.
You're living in the past,
right?
And not with it. But that's, of course, the reality. If you go to the science, which is the factual, that's not true. So that's the important thing, is to spread the information about that. I saw according to polls here, if you can believe them, about 60% of the people are in favor of divorce now, unfortunately. That's probably been growing over time because of influence from outside.
Right.
That's the primary reason. So
right. So people overseas can support you, can help you by just becoming better informed, yeah, and prepared to talk about these issues.
Yes, yeah. And for believers, pray,
Yes.
Don't doubt that.
Yes. Well, and I should think that people who are living in the United States would have some observations of their own about the reality of divorce, about how it has really gone down compared to the promises that have been made about it, and that their testimony then might be valuable to the people back in the Philippines. Do you guys have a website or a newsletter or anything like that that people can sign up for?
Yeah, we do. We do have a website, and it's Alliance. It's alfi.org.ph, ALFI. We're known as ALFI since the beginning, alfi.org.ph. But if you can just Google Alliance for the Family Foundation Philippines, there is an American Alliance for the Family Foundation, but it's in a different field, I think, and has nothing to do with us.
I see.
So
we can
also, we do have Facebook, so you can look that up on Facebook, and we have Instagram. There it's ALFI Philippines, ALFI PHILIPPINES. But again, you can search for these things. So
yes, yeah. Yes. So we can put all of these things into the show notes, so that people can look for it and find it. Do you have a newsletter or anything like that?
Our newsletter gets published on the website.
Good.
We don't send it out at this point. Well, very limited. Although we've been trying to move forward on these things.
Yes.
Have to do that, but still in development, I guess.
Yes. So we have an electronic newsletter, which costs very little to produce compared to sending paper in the mail. No one sends paper in the mail anymore. but people can stay in touch with you and stay in touch with what you're doing by going to your Facebook page, which gets updated fairly regularly, it sounds like.
Yes, that's correct.
Yes. Good.
And we do have our position papers on divorce. And another hot issue, so to speak, is teenage pregnancies here. Bill in Congress, again, very destructive. The solution to teenage pregnancies is to give contraceptives to teenagers and teach them and give them comprehensive sex education, which teaches kids about how to have sex from like third grade. So, obviously this is not going to be beneficial. But it's there, and many people think it will, because it's education, comprehensive sex education.
Right. And once again, we have paved the way with this and proven that it doesn't work. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have ample evidence here from the United States. Tell me something. Do you know what is the non-marital childbearing rate in the Philippines right now? Do you know what it is now?
Yeah, I do know. Wait, I haven't looked at that for a while.
We've got time, Father.
I think it's up to 50%. I think it is.
Is that right? Non-marital childbearing.
I believe so. Yeah. So higher than the States. I believe.
Well,
that's very surprising to me. But I'm pretty sure that's the right. That's
okay. The one thing that we've noticed in the States that you will notice too as you move down this track is that the non-marital childbearing rate is the highest among the poorest people. Okay, so if you break it down by education or income or anything like that, but people who've got a high school education, they have much higher non-marital childbearing than the educated classes. So people who have advanced degrees, college educated people, their non-marital birth rate is not so different from what the whole country was in the 1950s. Yes. But the poorer you get, the worse it is, the more the family fragmentation is a factor. And that feeds directly into the poverty point you were making earlier, Tim. Yes. Yeah. You know, because the people who need family cooperation, the people who need to have the family resource working together as a team, they're the very ones who have nobody to count on, who have nobody to depend on. And it's been a disaster from multiple points of view. Mm-hmm. And contraception does not solve the problem. Contraception and the promotion of contraception feeds the problem.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that we became well aware of that with the fight, 13 years of fighting the reproductive health bill. Yeah.
Right, right.
So if I may, I always say to people, because they don't believe it, but it's true. Again, based on what Land Pritchett wrote, Land Pritchett and the other one who wrote on it was George Akerlof, who won the Nobel Prize in Economics. Contraceptives are not very effective in cutting population growth and cutting births, but they're very effective in moving those births from inside marriage to outside marriage. That's what they do. That's the real result of contraception. Not for individual people, but in the aggregates of the society, that's what it does.
That's exactly right, which means that the poor get poorer and the rich get richer, right? Because now, today, in the United States, the biggest marker of child well-being is, are your parents married, right? Mm. And are your parents, if your parents are married, that gives you enormous advantages, including economically and every other way. So if you grow up in a married household, you're more likely to go to college, you're more likely to accumulate wealth, you're more likely to get married and stay married yourself, right? Mm. So the gap, every generation, that gap gets bigger, you know? Yeah. So
it's unfortunate.
Yeah, that's the unfortunate reality. I'll also mention, we have a small book created here at the Ruth Institute by one of our colleagues who was herself a child of divorce. And this booklet is called Marriage and Equality. And she wrote this around the time that we were debating over gay marriage, because everybody's talking about marriage equality, marriage equality, marriage equality. And this woman, her parents were divorced when she was a toddler, and both of her parents went on to remarry. Okay. And so when she was growing up, she moved from one house to the next on a regular basis, right? And what she saw was her half-sister got to live with both of her parents all the time. Mm-hmm. Her half-sister got to be with mom and dad all the time, and she never had to move, you know, whereas Jennifer was moving every week. She was going back and forth, you know, and she noticed that her half-sister had family photos all over the place that included both of her parents, whereas she had family photos, had no family photos. She has two pictures of herself with both parents. Okay. Mm-hmm. So she's at one house and there's her mom's side of the family. She's at the other house, her dad's side of the family. Right. But she's never whole. So the inequality between children is enormous, right? That divorce and non-marital childbearing generally, it introduces inequalities in the life of children that would be unheard of any other way. And I'm telling you this, Tim, we have this booklet. We'll send you some if you want them. But I'm telling you this because people don't think very many moves ahead, you know, as far as what the long-term consequence of this is going to be.
Yeah. Well, with much of anything, it seems these days, that's one of the problems.
Right, right. So at this point, this bill is being considered, and it's in the hopper, I guess, of something that's going to keep coming up. But there's not an immediate threat right now, if I understand that.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah. Okay. Very unlikely. You know, we could always get surprised. Sometimes things move very quickly that no one was aware of it, but that's unusual, very unusual. So.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, so Tim, this has been a really fascinating conversation. I'm sure that many of our people are going to be very blessed by it. And I do urge you, Ruth Institute listeners, if you have friends of Filipino descent, please send them this video. If you have a Filipino priest, which we had many Filipino priests in our place in California. If you have a Filipino priest, please send him this so that he can be aware of what's going on, that there are people who are trying to deal with it. Tim, do you have any final words for us?
I'm a person of few words, I think. So I appreciate this opportunity to have presented what's going on here so that you and people in the U.S. can learn about it. So, that's all.
Well, Tim Laws of the Alliance for the Family Foundation in the Philippines, thank you so much for being my guest today on the Dr. J Show.
Thank you very much.